On behalf of Belfast Trades Council, I'd like you, to welcome everybody to the Annual Mayday Lecture, which we hold every year as part of the Mayday Festival. For those in the room that I don't know, which isn't very many, I have to say, my name's Naomi Connor, and I'll be the chair for tonight's event. It'll involve a lecture from Kerry-Anne Mendoza, who has travelled over to see us, followed by a question and answer session. And the title of tonight's lecture is The Demolition of the Welfare State and the Rise of the Zombie Economy, which is also the title of Kerry-Anne's book, which I'm delighted to say is on sale tonight as well. It's a very apt one, I would say, given the current situation we're in relation to cuts and indeed the most recent announcements which were made as part of the Stormont House Agreement in December. And that really signalled one clear intent, and that intent was the ramping up of austerity. Kerry-Anne's lecture is a look behind the euphemistic nature of austerity, and rather by a means that we must save the economy, Kerry-Anne asserts that austerity is an opportunity that has been seized upon by neoliberals to pursue their decades-long project to shrink the state and along with it our most cherished public services, including health and education. But just before we move on to Kerry-Anne's contribution, I'd like to say something on behalf of the Trades Council on the whole subject of austerity, the welfare state and the economy. And I think it's taken on more relevance in recent months, and that's why tonight's lecture is keenly relevant, and it's keenly relevant to the quickening pace of the neoliberal North. I think it's true to say that all of us have now talked the talk of austerity for the best part of 5 years, and for a host of reasons here in Northern Ireland, the notion of austerity was somewhat of a UK one. It was somewhat of a notion that was out there and wasn't really here. The Assembly took the decision to backload the cuts by 4 years, but what we have seen unfold in Northern Ireland in recent months clearly demonstrates that that's no longer the case. And we are witnessing cuts delivered with a speed and with a ferocity, the like of which are unprecedented. I think it's fair to assert that there's almost an element of shock and awe about the speed and ferocity of the cuts, and I think it's something that trade unions are struggling to respond to. I think it's something the communities and people themselves are struggling to respond to as well. But alongside the austerity budget, another convenient conversation is taking place, and that conversation is about the shape and direction of the Northern Ireland economy. I think it's no accident that that conversation has taken place alongside it, but we're not invited to that conversation. Richard Ramsay, the chief economist of the Ulster Bank, stated recently that Northern Ireland had reached a watershed regarding decisions on public sector cuts, and it was time people in Northern Ireland accepted cuts had to happen and identified the areas to implement them. Now, aside from that democratic deficit opening up and developing fast apace, these decisions seem to be only the preserve of politicians and business leaders, as they've come to be known, and their cheerleaders, the neoclassical economists. And they seem to appear endlessly in local press and comment on everything from education to agriculture. As bystanders, we have now witnessed the Titanic Quarter, which isn't too far from here, emerge as the new investment and financial centre of Belfast and indeed the north of Ireland. It's being depicted as a wealthy financial oasis that is marketed as the epicentre of a bright new post-conflict city, which is open for business. The prosperity promise would appear to hinge on the development of Titanic Quarter as Northern Ireland's City of London in miniature. The increasing tendency to present the Titanic Quarter as a financial, economic and cultural hub of the North is most certainly born out of the neoliberal city model. A city model which has been pursued relentlessly in recent years by politicians, economists and business leaders alike, and a city model which, like neoliberalism itself, is presented as a rational state of being with an air of inevitability at the expense of any alternative vision. So what does this new city look like, and what does the post-conflict economy hold? Firstly, we have the corporatisation of the economy and a shift towards an investment finance economy based in the city of Belfast, mainly in and around what has become known as the Titanic Quarter. We have centres of finance, law and accountancy, such as Citigroup, moving in to inhabit that public space, not only at an alarming rate, but some of whom, in fact most of whom, are bolstered and supported by public monies, such as grants from InvestNI, among other public sector cash cows. also changing is the face of employment in Northern Ireland and the nature of employment, which is also now built almost solely on the free market logic of trickle-down economics. Titanic Quarter, when it came into being, boasted that it would create 35,000 new jobs. And even though these have never materialised, the logic of trickle-down is clung to. We have witnessed the loss of 900 well-paid jobs in manufacturing in the northwest, in the Ballymena region, which is one of the most deprived areas in the whole of the UK. And we've also been told that there are 20 to 30,000 public sector jobs to go in the next few years. We aren't meant to worry about that, and what's meant to soothe us are announcements such as that of PricewaterhouseCoopers, who said that they were to create 800 jobs over the next 5 years in the finance sector in Belfast, and no prizes for guessing where. A trend has also developed of attaching an average salary, which is hugely inflated from the realities of the salaries paid. But just like the 35,000 jobs that were to come in the first few years of Titanic Quarter, we have to ask, will these jobs ever come? We seem to be stripping away our manufacturing industries and our public sector jobs in favour of a reliance on futuristic jobs created by foreign direct investment that don't materialise in the numbers claimed and don't attract the salaries announced. The reality is what is now being delivered is much smaller amounts of low-paid service, finance and call centre jobs, and we are witnessing the expansion of a casualised and, more importantly, a non-unionised workforce. All of this leaves the North in the hands of free market thinking, with no alternative vision other than a moribund economic model that politicians alike seem content to pursue. We are witnessing the reduction of the public sector, employment which is reliant on attracting FDI, the lowering of corporation tax, or what I've heard it referred to recently, the economic equivalent of arguing that you don't need to work on Monday because you've bought a lottery ticket this Saturday, reliance on an overinflated housing market, a low-wage economy, and the casualisation of the labour market. And the result of this will be an increase in unemployment and underemployment, the privatisation of what remains of the social housing stock, increased consumer debt, a return to charity and philanthropy, which is seen as good. It's incredible to think that the opening of food banks is somehow seen as good. An increasing tendency towards corporate social responsibility as a means to replace and indeed privatise the public services we hold so dear. So all the while European governments, including our own in Stormont and Westminster, are hooking us up and addicting us to austerity, the real conversation about the economy is going on in glass-fronted offices, and working-class communities are firmly outside the door. I think it's fair to say that our new city is being shaped as a city for investors and tourists, and not citizens and communities, and we are moving ever closer to the zombie economy. With all that in mind, Kerry's contribution tonight is more than welcome. Kerry-Anne, as many of you know, is a former management consultant in banking, local government and the NHS. Wait for it though. She left her job there to join the Occupy protests, and she blogs at the brilliant Scriptonite Daily, which you should subscribe to if you're not a member already. And in her best-selling book, which is available tonight, Kerry-Anne argues that austerity is not a short-term disruption to balance the books. It is a demolition of our welfare state. So Kerry-Anne, you're very welcome to Belfast, and we're looking forward to hearing.
What a welcome. It's really thank you to the Belfast Trades Council for having me here. It's really great to be in Belfast. This is my wife is here tonight filming this, and this is our first time in Northern Ireland and our first time in Belfast. It's just an extraordinary opportunity to get to speak to you all about austerity and the demolition of the welfare state and the rise of the zombie economy. And before I go into, you know, why I wrote the book and the kind of content of what I'm going to talk about tonight, I just wanted to let you know who I am. Some of you may never have heard of me before. My name is Kerry-Anne. I grew up in a predominantly white working class area of Bristol called Kingswood. It's like a little suburb. And I'm the sort of descendant of, on the one side, my granddad came over from the Caribbean after World War II and married a white woman in Bristol in the 1950s, which was not the done thing. He worked really heavily with the integrationist movement. He helped set up a place called the Bamboo Club, which was the first bar club in Bristol where black and white, you know, mixed race couples could actually go together and not be kicked out. And he met Harold Wilson. He was really heavily involved in that stuff. And I actually didn't know any of that until he died. So he was just my granddad in Easton in Bristol. And then at his funeral, there were hundreds and hundreds of people. The church was full, there were people outside. And then they put a plaque up to him in Easton. And it was the very first time I'd heard these stories. And it kind of made sense to me of some sort of genetic inheritance that I had, which was this feeling of like, get involved. You know, this world is ours to shape. We're not just bystanders in a world that exists outside of ourselves. Our lives matter, our decisions matter, and our views matter. And it is actually not only our responsibility, but our privilege to get to say how this whole situation works. And I kind of forgot that a little bit. I went off and ended up going into management consultancy, and I was working in banking, and then I was working in the NHS, and I was working in local government. And I was not only seeing, but I was being a party to the implementation of what I'm going to discuss with you tonight, which is the demolition of the welfare state and the rise of the zombie economy. And I started to question the whole approach that was business is always best, profit is always best. You know, private sector is always more efficient and better at delivering services that we need and want than the public sector. We don't need that public sector anymore. We've moved past it. This is like progress. I really don't think that way anymore. And when the Occupy movement happened in 2011, I couldn't help but be there. It was the closest thing to a calling I've ever had in my life. I had to be a part of this group of people that were asking the questions that I had been, they were asking the questions out loud that I had been asking myself quietly and internally, you know, for the best part of a decade. And I set up the Scriptonite daily blog in 2010 in the wake of the general election, which I think we've all lived to regret ever since. It was, this was before austerity really kind of kicked in the UK, and it's become one of the top independent political blogs in the UK. And what I do with that blog, which is what I've tried to do with this book, is tell the story of what's happening. Because what's happening, these aren't very complex ideas. These are actually quite simple, really easy to understand ideas that anybody in a pub, in a factory, in a school playground could be engaging with. And I believe that they're made deliberately complex, not only by the political kind of leadership, the political elite, but to some degree, the kind of academic elite as well. And so what we end up with, even when we have books or programs that deal with the issues at hand, they're articulated in a way, in a language that most people actually don't speak. And they find it intimidating and they find it alienating, and they think that's for those other people to talk about. That's for those people who've gone to university and got degrees to discuss, not for me. I don't do politics. I'm just a mum. I'm just a dad. I'm just a kid. So that's that. And what this book does is tells the story of austerity, where it comes from, who created it, who benefits from it, and who suffers. And it's an interesting one, because one of the things that both my grandparents understood, the grandparents that were born in Bristol, the grandparents that came over from the Caribbean, was the privilege of living in a country with a welfare state and a public sector. You know, when you're sick, being able to be treated without worrying about where that money's going to come from. Being able to send your children to get a first-class education without wondering where the money is going to come from. And what they knew was that those were not the benefits of capitalism, this story that is commonplace now. These were gifts of civilization that were handed to us by people who opposed capitalism. They were won from capitalism, not given to us by capitalism. And it's really important that people reconnect with that idea, because it ends a lot of confusion that people have about, well, why is stuff getting worse if the economy's growing? You know, if the economy's growing, how are people getting poorer? That's what this book sets out to answer. So where we begin really with is the history of austerity. And people often, you know, some people think that started in 2010. Some people think it started in 2008. Some people who have some idea of the concept of the economic idea, which is neoliberalism, would say, well, it was in the 70s, wasn't it? It was, you know, Milton Friedman and, you know, later Margaret Thatcher, and they all did it. But actually, austerity predates all of that. Neoliberalism predates all of that. And it kind of, you know, I'm really conscious tonight of the fact that I'm speaking in Belfast, and I really don't need to lecture a Northern Ireland crowd about the dangers of English imperialism. So I won't. But in 1944, as it was really kind of clear at this point which way the Second World War was going to go, it was clear that the kind of colonial powers were exhausted after this war. You know, all of the kind of the leading empires of the world were facing the end of the colonial era after this. And you had the rising dominance of the United States, which had kind of quite cleverly left itself out of the war long enough, you know, for most of Western Europe and the Allies to kind of deplete themselves, and then stepped in at the last minute. And it left them in a really, really strong position to barter at a meeting in Bretton Woods called the Bretton Woods Conference, which I'm sure most of you are aware of, which took place in 1944. And it was at this meeting, while the people who were actually fighting this war were preparing to come home and vote out Winston Churchill and build the welfare state that we rely on today, at this meeting, the economic powers were laying out a very different vision for how post-World War II Europe and America and the world, in fact, was going to look. And at this meeting, they set up the infrastructure of austerity. They set up the International Monetary Fund. They set up the sort of the beginnings of the World Bank, and they set up the beginning of the World Trade Organization, which would come to be essentially the three pillars of neoliberalism down the line. And really, the role of the IMF was to answer a question on the minds of the leaders of the what were to be post-imperial countries. I'm doing the bunny rabbit ears because I think we can all argue that colonialism and imperialism did not die at the end of the Second World War, or when, you know, ex-colonial countries gained independence. So the question was, how do we keep the benefits of colonialism without kind of colonialism as we've known it? How do we do that? And in the same way as in 1884, there was the Berlin Conference, where the empires got together and carved up Africa. They called it the magnificent African cake. This is what they did in 1944. How do we keep the cheap labor? How do we keep the access to their national resources? How do we stop them, you know, developing unions and having rights, you know, in the workplace? How are we going to do this? And then they got their answer. And it came through what I would describe as the zombie economy. And in short, how it worked in the first instance, the first kind of test run of austerity happened in Africa, and it happened in Latin America. And it was structural adjustment programs. Now, it began with this kind of OPEC countries thinking, where are we going to stash our money? Interest rates are so low in the West. You know, we're kind of hiving our money away, and it's not really making us any profit. So what do we do? So they launched a massive profligate lending spree across Africa, across the post-colonial world, mostly to kind of dictatorships that we'd installed anyway, because it was kind of handy, really, to have some puppet governments. You know, now you've not got your colonial governments installed anymore. And they did this profligate lending spree. And then you have the oil shocks of the 70s. So these countries that we've lent all this money to, these debtor nations, now they can't pay us back. Where is the profit going to come from? What are we going to do? And here steps in the IMF as the lender of last resort. So instead of allowing these countries to default on their payments, to restabilize their national economies and progress, What the creditor nation said was, no, what we want their economies to be focused on is servicing that debt. We're actually going to reorientate those their whole national economies so that the primary purpose is to service debt. And so what structural adjustment programs were these bailouts that said, oh, we'll lend you the money so that your banks don't collapse, but we're going to tie these conditions to it, like no unions, like stipulating how much a government could spend on national public services, on infrastructure, on education, on health. Really ending any kind of notion of democracy, because it doesn't matter who wins an election if the IMF has already dictated the spending plans of the state. No matter what they're promising their people, no matter what they're saying about, we're going to build national roads networks, we're going to build a national education system, we want to give healthcare to our people, none of that matters anymore, because they are going to be tied in to this reorientation towards servicing debt. And that's what they did. So it was about selling off national industries and resources. Nationalisation became effectively outlawed. Removing capital controls on the money coming in and out of a country. You've touched on foreign direct investment. It was all about essentially economically colonising these countries again without troops. They didn't need the troops anymore because they had the IMF to do that for them. And if you look at the figures, they are absolutely startling. And I think they draw into question this whole concept that certainly we have in the West of poor Africa, poor Latin America, poor developing third world, these horrible terms that we use. This international development, like somehow we're constantly helping these people and they're too inferior to develop their own economies. It's a really insidious idea that's taken a hold, and I think is actually supported by things like comic relief that perpetuate this idea. And if you look at figures, so between 1982 to 1990, there was £927 billion advanced to debtor states in loans. But what came back? What came back was £1.3 trillion paid back in debt service alone. It's just horrifying. Like, who's paying who? And 700 million of the world's poorest people are trapped in that cycle. They've had austerity since the 70s. By 2011, this is just 4 years ago, for every dollar creditor nations, predominantly in the West, gave to the developing world, the debtor nations, in foreign aid, those debtor nations gave back almost $5. Who's funding who? You know, we have to flip the whole narrative on its head. The West is not bailing out Africa or Latin America or the developing, so-called developing world. They're funding us. Like, they're not funding us, they're funding our banks. And it's really important to remember that sequence of events when you're looking at the financial crisis of 2007-08 and what's happened since with austerity, because it is exactly the same process. And just to recap on the financial crisis, I'm not going to go through the whole process. I know most of you in the room will know how that happened. But essentially, what do you have? Profligate lending on the basis that, you know, credit cards, credit card companies, retail banks, lending out money. They didn't care if it was ever going to be paid back because that wasn't where their profit was coming from. Their profit came from selling that debt, mostly never going to be paid back debt. They would pass it on to investment banks who would get out their Excel spreadsheets and they would pile up all of these toxic debts and they would call them collateralized debt obligations. And they would then go off to the credit ratings agency, which are like the cartel, really, of this kind of process. And then these credit ratings agencies would look at these, you know, fields of toxic debts, these kind of cartons full of toxic debt, and say, yep, that's AAA creditworthy. And then they would sell it on to pension funds. and states and local governments were even investing in these collateralised debt obligations. And then in 2007-08, you have the House of Cards start to fall. You have all of these over-leveraged debtors unable to meet their debt repayments. And then that hits the retail banks, and that hits the investment banks. But the best bit is, while the investment banks had been going and selling all of these toxic debts as AAA creditworthy, they'd actually been insuring themselves with credit, these things called credit default swaps, against them collapsing. So it's kind of like the equivalent of an estate agent setting a fire in the basement of a house and then selling it to you and going, it's a great house, this is the best house you're ever going to buy, that'll be, you know, £500,000, please. And then running off to the insurance company and saying, yes, I'd like to take out insurance against that house burning down. That's effectively what they did. But in that case, you just have a one-to-one relationship. You have one toxic, one thing that's definitely going to go bad, and one person that's insured against it. But the problem with these credit default swaps is it was like a bet anyone could put down. So you've not just got one-to-one insurance, you've got Goldman Sachs and Barclays and Bear Stearns and AIG and all of these investment banks all taking out this insurance. Not even on just the toxic things they've sold, but on the toxic stuff Goldman Sachs sold as well and the other banks sold. So you just have this absolutely huge pile of, you know, over-leveraged debt and insurance policies built up. And then it collapsed. And instead of us going, guys, maybe this isn't the most sensible way to run our world, this is a really bad idea, we said, why don't we take £850 billion of public money, this is just in the UK, £850 billion, and bail out the people that have made these bad decisions and profited from it. Don't worry about the guys that and girls that are losing their homes. Don't worry about any of those people, like the debtors. Let's pay off the creditors. Let's pay off the people that are responsible for causing this catastrophe. It's beggar's belief. And just to put in perspective what £850 billion looks like, that's almost twice the total spending of the UK in a year on everything. It amounts to 8 years of funding the entire National Health Service. 8 years. It would fund the entire education system of the United Kingdom for 20 years. And this figure is, for me, the most astonishing. It would fund the bill for job seekers' allowance for every claimant for 200 years. And apparently the crisis was caused, you know, by the people on welfare. I really don't think so. And that brings to mind, before I move on, a joke, which I open a section of the book with, which effectively you can boil this whole thing down to a wonderful joke that I heard a couple of years ago, which was, you've got a banker, a teacher, and an immigrant sitting at a table. There's recognition over there. Sitting at a table and there's 10 biscuits. And while the teacher and the immigrant are deep in conversation, the banker just leans over, grabs nine of the biscuits and shoves a few in his mouth, a few in his pockets. And then he leans over to the teacher and he says, watch out, that immigrant's after your biscuit. And that's basically the level of political conversation that we've got in the mainstream at the moment, is fighting over who is going to have that remaining one biscuit. And we're not dealing with the nine biscuits, you know, that have been sucked away by this banker. And that's really where we're at. And it doesn't matter if it's, you know, in Westminster politics, it doesn't matter if it's Labour or Conservative or Liberal Democrat, they're all arguing over that one biscuit. How do we maybe make it fairer, the way that we distribute this one biscuit that we're left with? And none of them are signing up to taking on getting back those nine other biscuits. And that's where we need to be dealing. So you have the financial crisis, and you have, instead of going after those nine biscuits and putting the blame where it resides properly, which is with an economic system that fundamentally doesn't work, with an economic ideology which fundamentally doesn't work, and challenging it at source. We have scapegoats. We have too many immigrants, benefit tourism, health tourism. We have this, you know, toxic conversation about, oh, there's a woman down the street and she's on welfare and I've seen her playing with her kids, so I don't see anything wrong with her. We're literally, like, that's what this debate is reduced to, and it's encouraged and festered and nurtured by the political and economic class that benefit from that division. They benefit hugely from us looking at that one biscuit, blaming each other, scrabbling for crumbs, rather than going after them and their decisions and their politics. So what's happening in the UK predated austerity in 2010, and it actually, sadly, you know, if you look at the, it wasn't just Margaret Thatcher. I know certainly in the sort of the English left, we like to demonise Margaret Thatcher as if she was just the root of all evil. But actually the new Labour government really had a huge role to play in setting up the zombie economy. And the absolute centre of the zombie economy in the UK, the zombie economy is, I'll actually read a bit of the book to explain it, because I think it's a nice tagline, but it's worthy of explanation. So you have a real economy where you make stuff and you service needs. That's a real economy. You have a demand for something. Kids, we need to eat, we need shelter, we need stuff, cars, whatever it is. And so someone has a good idea that meets someone else's need, they create that, and then it exists, and we fund that. And that's an economy. It's a service, it's a way that we distribute resources for each other. But that's not the way the zombie economy works. Because under capitalism and neoliberalism, there's no such thing as enough. Ever. Because they're always trying to answer the question, how do you create infinite growth with finite resources and customers? How do you do that? So the zombie economy answers that question. So I'm just going to read a short paragraph from the book that's a metaphor of that. So the question is, so how do you keep... Take water as an example. So water has immense value, but it only has as much utility as there are people who need to drink it or use it in other ways. So how do you keep increasing profits on water in an economic system that demands infinite growth? Well, first, as a water magnate, you can set out to buy all of the water and gain control over the total water supply and production. You succeed, you've done that. Now you've increased your customer base. But then what? Well, you could get people to pay you to have shares in the proceeds from what people pay for their water. And these shareholders and others would run the company. So you succeed in that. You retain control over the company, you continue to receive profits, and you don't have to do all the work anymore. Now what? Well, you could have people bet on whether the price of water will go up or down. You realise you can actually then manipulate the price of water yourself by creating scarcity or a range of other means, which means the house always wins. So you succeed and you reap more profit. Now what? Well, you could place your own bets on the stock market with this notional money that you've made from all those bets on water prices. In all this time, the price of water for those using it creeps up continually. The consumers have to pay now not only for the water, but the profits and losses all the way up this giant chain. They're getting no greater utility from their water. That remains constant. But they're forced, through monopoly, to pay ever higher prices. And that's how financialization works. It takes something that has utility, and without increasing the utility or adding value, it generates ever greater costs to the users and ever greater profits in the short term to the owners. And that financialisation is now being implemented across the public services of the UK. They're taking something we need, they're not adding to the utility of it, they're not adding to the value of it, but they're finding ways to extract ever greater profit from providing those services, and it costs us. And one of the main instruments, well, the main instrument that they've used to advance that agenda is the Private Finance Initiative. And the Private Finance Initiative, as most of you know, is effectively the transition from government borrowing, raising money on the gilt markets, to using private banks, private money, private lending, to fund public infrastructure and services. And there are really huge benefits of doing this for the government and for the private banks that are doing it. There are zero benefits to you, me, and the rest of the people actually using those services. In fact, those PFI loans are minimum. The best deal we've ever got on a PFI loan was twice the interest rate of normal government borrowing. Twice. It's like the equivalent of buying a house with a Wonga loan or a credit card versus having a mortgage. Like, that's the mentality behind this. But what it gives the government is allows them to push debt off the government's balance sheet. So they can say, look, debt's going down. And you can't see the huge pile building up of this PFI debt. It also means that individual departments can actually increase their own budgets without ever taking any more money from the capital that the government has to spend through taxes. So they can just kind of infinitely expand their own portfolios. But the most insidious thing is that it allows the private sector to build national delivery networks for public services on the taxpayer's dime. So if you think about you're in the private healthcare industry, what's your main problem with going up and tackling the NHS? Imagine the outlay that they would have to put down to compete on a national basis with the health service, a hospital, a doctor's surgery on every street corner. How are they going to do that? This is how they're doing that. We're paying to build their network. And the problem with PFI is it's effectively a mortgage that lasts for about 25 to 30 years. It's a huge investment. And this started kind of in the early 90s with Norman Lamont, but the new Labour government took a bad idea and just went crazy with it. Basically, you'll struggle to find a hospital, a school, or any public infrastructure in the last 20 years that wasn't built as a PFI project. And by 2011, 22 of the 103 NHS trusts that have PFI deals were in financial distress. We've borrowed £54.7 billion. That's the amount of money that we actually borrowed to build stuff. And we're going to pay back, we're scheduled to pay back £301 billion. £301 billion over 25 years. And if you want an idea about how that's likely to go, £70 million worth of PFI schools have already closed. In fact, I heard earlier today there's actually one in Belfast. The PFI school has already shut its doors. They're just going bankrupt. Now, if you wanted to be really cynical, or in my view, realistic, the bank that lends the PFI scheme retains ownership of that public infrastructure until the debt is repaid. So you could argue it would be in their interest to make it unaffordable. Because if it is, in 25 years, they'd have made a huge profit from interest payments and retained the asset. And that's exactly what's happening. Right now, banks own at least 91 pieces of public infrastructure, from bridges to roads to schools to police stations to hospitals. And in fact, HSBC, money launderer, tax evader service to the billionaires of our country, now own three NHS hospitals outright, wholly owned by HSBC Bank. Why should we care? Some people go, well, who cares? But the hospital's still there. The school's still there. I don't care if it's the government that owns it or it's HSBC that owns it. Well, there's four really good reasons to care. One is the financial cost. Even it might be free at the point of use, but it isn't free. We are actually paying it. You know, our national debt is totting up. Our taxes will go up. All of the hidden taxes go up, our prices for things go up, and our service levels drop. There's the human cost, and I'll talk more to that point shortly, but people die because of this. People get substandard education because of this. You know, the public services that they rely on are not there for them when they need them because of this. There's a huge human cost. Third issue is the economy. You know, when you have a public service, a national project, like a road building project or a house building project, where it's public money paid to public service workers for a publicly owned asset, all that money recycles within our economy, so we all benefit from it. With PFI, a lot of these shell companies that banks set up to actually create the PFI deal in the first place, they don't even pay tax, they're offshore. So first of all, you've got the profit that's going to that private company leaving your economy. You've got the money that would have been paid in taxes going offshore. And oftentimes, you've got the jobs themselves going offshore. So you're losing skills, you're losing tax money, and you're losing the money that would come back from the service. And the ultimate game is that these services fail. And the best bit is when they do, the blame is never placed on the financialisation that crippled them. In fact, the argument is they didn't financialise enough. They weren't commercial enough. So they actually take the poison, which has already killed the service, and they say the cure is more of the poison. And that's what's happening. And nowhere is that clearer if you look at the case of Hinchinbrook Hospital in England, where you have a hospital that was crippled by PFI debt. It had something like £40 million. It just couldn't close this gap in its budget sheet. And it folded because we now treat hospitals like businesses and not public services. And the answer was, we're going to sell it wholly to a private company called Circle, who have told us magically that they can run this service for a profit and pay back the debt. And unsurprisingly to anyone who's got GCSE maths or common sense, Circle failed at that, but not before service levels crashed through the floor, hundreds of staff lost their jobs, and now that hospital is laying empty, and no one knows what to do with it. But we do know what to do with it, but no one's going to do that. It's not going to be renationalised. It'll probably go to Virgin or someone else who can also cock it up. So that's kind of health in a nutshell. Outsourcing and PFI. And the record for New Labour was just crazy enough. They actually blew £78 million in 70 reorganisations of the NHS in just 4 years, between 2005 and 2009. Endless cycles of management speak and choice and progress. That's bad enough. But the Coalition, with their Health and Social Care Act, blew £4 billion on that single reorganisation in the first 4 years that they were in power. So you constantly have this money being hived off. If it's not going on PFI, it's going on these reorganisations. And by 2020, it's anticipated that 40% of the NHS will be outsourced in that way, to hand it over entirely to private providers, because that's what essentially the Health and Social Care Act does, is it, with these things called competition regulations, it enforces this idea that the NHS must outsource. And that was felt in particular, if you've ever heard of the Mid-Staffordshire scandal, the healthcare scandal, we had, you know, crazy stuff. So to gain foundation trust status under New Labour, they actually changed. You have this ward called the acute ward, which is basically where people go when they're at the most medical distressing point. You don't know if they're going to live or die. And the recommended nursing to patient ratio was one nurse to six patients. They changed that to one nurse to 15, in the most critical point in people's care. the recommended ratio for trained medical staff versus trainees was 60-40. They reversed it to 40-60. They had an internal review halfway through this process that said they actually needed 77 more staff. The response of the management team, because they wanted to gain this foundation status, was to sack 52 staff. The result was 1,200 excess deaths. The mortality rate at that hospital was about 35% above the national average. People did literally die. And to just give you an idea of what happened in that hospital, and then they finally got round to doing an inquiry into midstaffs, they found that patients were left in excrement in soiled bedclothes for lengthy periods. They found that assistance was not provided with feeding for patients who couldn't eat without help. So you have patients literally starving to death in NHS hospital wards. Water was left out of reach. You have patients drinking out of vases. In spite of persistent requests for help, patients were not even assisted with toileting, which meant they were soiling themselves in their own beds. Wards and toilet facilities were left in a filthy condition. Privacy and dignity, even in death, were denied. Triage in A&E was undertaken by untrained staff. You literally had receptionists prioritising people's healthcare needs as they came into accident and emergency. And staff treated patients and those close to them with what appeared to be callous indifference. That's the human cost of financialising the National Health Service. And moving on from health to education, what we see now in the UK is that most children are now actually being educated in privately owned schools run by private institutions, even though their parents think they're going to state schools. And this has been put through by the Academies and Free Schools programme. So academies are limited companies. Ditto free schools. And the Public Accounts Committee investigated what was happening with this Academy and Free Schools programme a little over a year ago, and found that there was £1 billion of overspending. And that £1 billion had come from state school funding. So you actually had infrastructure for state schools, these are the schools that aren't rebranded as academies, cut by 81%. And you had the regular budget for the schools cut by 4%. At the same time, funding for academy schools rose by 191%. So you actually have state schools being replaced by these limited companies. And this was all sold under the idea of the localism agenda. So we're going to take these schools, you've heard Gove probably go on about this, said we're going to take these schools out of the control of local authorities, those bureaucrats. What he didn't say was, and we're going to put them into the hands of a couple of hundred, maybe, civil servants in Westminster. So actually it's the reverse of localism, where you did have at least a local government that was looking at the educational needs. You now have just a handful of bureaucrats in Westminster. It is absolutely the centralisation of power. You also have the selling off of tuition fees to private banks. The government commissioned the Rothschild Bank to actually put together a plan for the sale of tuition fees. You have 3.6 million graduates facing retrospective interest rate rises on their tuition fees and their student loans. It's absolutely terrifying. But nowhere has this been felt more than in the field of social security and the welfare, the benefits that support the people that need them, and often the most vulnerable people in our society. And really, we need to think about social security like the very foundation of a civilised social democracy. A decent social security system protects us all, people who are working and people who aren't working. Because what it does for people who are working is it protects them from being vulnerable to exploitative labour conditions.
It's like, we don't need you. It's okay, we're going to fund ourselves, and unless we get these decent labour conditions, we're just going to withdraw labour, and we'll fund each other for a while until you sort yourselves out. And that's being taken away. It's bad enough for the people who are working, but the people who aren't working really get it. So the working so first of all, you have workfare, which is the idea that people now need to work for their benefits, like they didn't already. You know, like generations before them didn't already. It actually breaks the bond between work and pay. The idea that an employer should remunerate you for your labour, it breaks that bond. And it says that it's acceptable for the taxpayer to fund forced labour for corporations. That's what's happening. And in the process of doing that, you completely undermine the minimum wage. Because if you're Tesco, who are you going to employ to stack your shelves? Are you going to pay someone's national insurance, the employer's tax contributions, and a minimum wage? Or are you going to get the state to fund a workfare person for you? It's an absolute disaster for working people and non-working people alike. You also have the bedroom tax and the housing crisis. And the housing crisis is where I'm going to begin, because you have this idea of right to buy under Margaret Thatcher as if it was the end of the class system in the United Kingdom, effectively. The working class were going to become the new property-owning class. It was all going to be champagne and tiaras. It was going to be absolutely brilliant. But what they failed to tell you is that home ownership is just 9% higher today than it was in 1979. 9%. And what has it cost us? More than a third of former council houses reside now in the property portfolios of wealthy landlords. A third. And in fact, a little anecdote, Margaret Thatcher's housing minister at the time, the guy who actually implemented the right to buy scheme, ended up buying up more than 40 ex-council houses all on his own. So he personally benefited from his own scheme. And you also see this transition. Prior to right to buy, about 85% of public spending on housing went on the supply side. So that's building the houses, maintaining the houses. Since by 2009, post right to buy, you have the absolute opposite. Like 85% of public funding on housing goes on the demand side. It goes on housing benefit, principally, that's 50% of which is paid to private landlords. So you move from a situation where the public spending is focused on building housing and keeping it safe to just funding the profiteering of private landlords. I have no idea where I am on time, so if someone lets me know. Brilliant, thank you. And that's kind of had typical results, is you have the social housing supply just dwindle to the point where, instead of where it began, the idea that housing is a right, warm, safe shelter is a right, and we should actually fund it together to make sure that we're all living in safe, affordable housing, and then we can spend our wages rather than the whole bulk of it going to crazy profiteering private landlords. We can spend it on maybe going to the restaurant or supporting someone else's business somewhere else. So that money would recycle in the economy. To this weird situation where council housing is so stigmatised, it's supposed to only go to the poorest of the poor. It's like a lifeline rather than a right. And since 2009, just since 2009, there's been an 86% rise in housing benefit claims. There was a 37% rise in rents in just the 3 years after austerity, just to 2012. And between 2001 and 2011, just that small window of time, a decade, house prices went up 94%. And wages only went up 29%. So you can see the problem. And you also have the impact on the disabled, the sick, and elderly people. And essentially, these people that are seen as not able to generate profit for this financialized zombie economy are suddenly viewed as surplus to requirements, as dependents that we can simply no longer afford. It's like the people that are weighing us down, like they're the problem now. Which is so absurd, because an economy exists to serve the demographics that exist. That's the only purpose of the economy. It's there to serve us all. So if you took a metaphor and said, look at your shoes. The purpose of your shoes is to cover your feet. So if your feet grow, the logic is to say these shoes are no longer fit for purpose. I'm going to buy a bigger pair of shoes. Under the logic of neoliberalism and austerity, you would cut your toes off. You know, that's where we're at today. And that's had a real impact. That attitude of these dependents that we can no longer afford had real impacts. Hate crimes against disabled people rose 25% between 2010 and 2012. Because people were being attacked. People with invisible illnesses were being attacked. And people with very, very clear invisible illnesses were being attacked. In the 1 year between 2010 and 2011, 10,600 sick and disabled people died while going through the ATOS work capability assessment process. To put that in perspective, that's 204 people a week, 29 people a day. That's more than a person an hour dying. 2,200 of those died before the verdict came down from ATOS. They died the most vulnerable time in their lives, unsure where their next meal was going to come from, in that terrifying, vulnerable circumstance of economic uncertainty, financial uncertainty. And the most disgraceful statistic is that over 1,300 of those people who died had been declared fit for work. And I'm just going to, if I could give you just some examples of those people, because it's an awful number, but we don't often talk about the individuals. And here are some individuals that were caught up in that. Linda Wooden, 49, was on 10 medications a day after a double lung and heart transplant. She was weak and suffered regular bouts of blackouts. She was put through the ATOS work capability assessment. And as she lay in a hospital bed dying, she received confirmation she was fit to work. She died 9 days later after she received that letter. Her husband Peter said, "I sat there and listened to my wife drown in her own bodily fluids. It took half an hour for her to die, a woman who is apparently fit for work." Brian McCardle was 57. He'd been left paralysed down one side, blind in one eye, unable to speak properly, and barely able to eat and dress himself after a stroke on Boxing Day 2011. Despite this, he was deemed fit to work by ATOS. He died of a heart attack the day after his benefit payments were stopped. His 13-year-old son, Kieran, told the Daily Record, "Even though my dad had another stroke just days before his assessment, he was determined to go. He tried his best to walk and talk because he's a very proud man, but even an idiot could have seen my dad wasn't fit for work." And Colin Traynor, who was 29, suffered from epilepsy. He was deemed fit for work by ATOS and forced to enter a lengthy bureaucratic process to appeal the decision, during which his benefits were frozen. He didn't live to see the result of his appeal. 5 weeks after his death, his family received the news that his appeal had been successful. It was too late for Colin. His father, Ray, said, "I firmly believe, 100% believe, that the system this government introduced has killed my son." At the rate at which people are dying, these three people represent the death toll in just the last 3 hours. This is not just some occasional poor decision. This is a Linda, a Brian, or a Colin, every hour, all day, every day, dying because this system is designed to throw people out of the social security system, whether they need it or not. And that's where we're at. I'm conscious that I'm running low on time, so I'm going to skip the bit on the elderly, which is terrifying, so do read the book if you want to find out what's happening to them. So I'm in my conclusion now. And I want to conclude on the fact that austerity is absolutely ideological. Austerity is not born of necessity. It is, I mean, it's almost like zealotry. I mean, it's crazy, this ideology. And how you know it's based in ideology rather than workability or fact or research or any kind of scientific approach is that the idea, according to George Osborne, our Chancellor, I hope not for very much longer, there was a 2010 Harvard paper put together by a guy called Ken Rogoff and Carmen Reinhart, and which George Osborne described as the most significant contribution to our understanding of the financial crisis. That's a quote from 2010-11. The problem was when MIT, another big university in the States, attempted to reproduce the results of the Rogoff-Reinhart study, they couldn't. So they contacted the team at Harvard and said, well, can you supply us with, you know, the data modeling that you use to, you know, come up with these analyses? And they discovered that this cutting-edge piece of research was actually based in one Excel spreadsheet. Not only that, but someone had actually cocked up the formulas, which actually meant that their conclusion, which was that a country with high debt of 90% or more, its economy will shrink by around 1%. Actually, turns out if you added up all of the numbers in the column, it would grow by 2.2%. It's kind of quite a big, big problem. And so you have that pillar of austerity ideology just demolished as a complete fabrication and a mistake, if you want to be benevolent about it. And then in 2013, the architects of austerity, the International Monetary Fund, actually explicitly say to George Osborne, you probably remember it, it was in all the papers, George, you've gone too far with this austerity. You've got to roll it back. You're killing your economy. So if you were looking at this from a non-ideological perspective, you believed austerity was workable because the IMF said it was, and because of this paper, which was apparently the foundation of your belief system, how do you respond when you find out these two pillars have just been taken away? You would, if you were coming from a non-ideological perspective, surely pause for a moment and reflect on your decisions. Maybe change your ideas. There was not one pause. This government did not skip a beat in pursuing austerity any further. It was just dismissed out of hand. And finally, austerity is dangerous. By 2018, it's just 3 years away, the welfare state will have been rolled back 60 years. We will have the lowest public spending since the 1930s. And it's important to note because we didn't have an NHS in the 1930s, we also didn't have a national education system in the 1930s. And there was an incredible study by Gregory Clark at the University of California, which studied this whole period of neoliberal economics and actually found that in terms of social mobility, the idea that the next generation has more prosperity than yours, it's really weird. Whatever economic system we've had through 1,000 years since feudalism, there's been the same, about the same rate of social mobility. It's run at about 5%. They almost thought it was like a physical law. It's kind of like weird, like whatever we do, mercantilism, capitalism, whatever we use, it's 5%. It must just be how stuff works. In the 30 years of neoliberalism, for the first time in 1,000 years, the rate of social mobility has declined. They've actually managed to break what we believed was almost a physical law of social mobility. And that's where we come now. I was going to finish on reading the final chapter of the book, a bit from the final chapter, but I don't think there's really time to do that. But what I did want to end on was a kind of a more optimistic note. This book is actually all about what's wrong. I set out to do one book originally, which was like, what's wrong? Here's some ideas about how we can fix it, and then here's how we're gonna do it. And I realised that actually, you do need to devote a whole book to just the fundamental causes of where we are, because this is just one book. And actually, the people that are out there who are gonna vote in a week for the next government and who are making decisions about who to place their faith in are every day, in every paper they read, pretty much, in every news programme that they watch, in every politician that they hear on the television, gonna hear a different story. They're in that all of the time. The scapegoating of immigrants, the scapegoating of people on benefits, the scapegoating of old people for apparently now the crime of living too long. That's the world they live in. And so I wanted to close on the idea that I didn't write this book and the books that will come after it, you know, what we're going to do to get out of this, what we're going to create and how we're going to do it, because I think that the system that we live in now and the people that are operating it and everyone else in it is evil. It's actually not the viewpoint I have. I'm campaigning, I'm an activist, because I think that human beings are infinitely capable and infinitely ingenious. And we are so capable of creating a world that actually works for everyone. It's completely possible. It's within our grasp. And to me, the question isn't if this system is replaced, if we build a more workable system. It's not if, it's when. And I want that when to be as soon as humanly possible, so that no other child, disabled person, sick person, working person, non-working person has to suffer like the people that we've seen suffer. And you will see suffer if you read this book, or if you just walk down the street or talk to your family and friends. And to me, that's a worldview that we need to advance, which isn't about any single political ideology. It's the idea of responsibility. And we really need to stop looking around at each other, at politicians, like somewhere from over the hill the cavalry is going to come. What we need to get in our bones is that we are the cavalry. We're it. This is our world. It's ours to shape and build and create. And that's what we need to get busy doing. So thank you so much for your time and attention tonight. Defining moment where I just went, I can't do this anymore. There were kind of several. One was I was working in Somerset. I was doing a contract role for, I was working as a consultant, essentially a consultant project manager to Sedgemoor District Council, and they were looking at the new build of the nuclear power station. And at that point I was kind of ambivalent about nuclear power. I was sort of in the middle. I was kind of like, well, I can see the pros and cons to this. I didn't have a fixed position. And I was actually on the council side, so I wasn't working for EDF Energy, who were trying to build the power station. I was actually working on the council side to kind of assess this application and see where it went. And I'm not going to go into too much detail about what happened, but there's just some stuff you can't unsee. And I found out, I very quickly became an absolute firm opponent of the nuclear energy industry. The whole cynical way in which I was witnessing and a party to manipulating the local community into seeing this power station as like the be all and end all. It was like it was going to create, you know, something like, let's say it was going to create 5,000 jobs, and they were like, but they're actually not going to be local jobs. We already know the people that we're going to be importing because they built the other new nuclear plant in France, so we're just going to have those guys over. But meanwhile, they were presenting publicly, guys, 5,000 new jobs are going to be coming to a really disadvantaged area called Bridgewater in Somerset. That got my goat a little bit, got my dander up, as we say in the West. And it was also the sort of, the whole conversation about economics was so skewed. So they would say, nuclear energy is cheaper than renewables. But they would use price comparisons where the cost of nuclear included a government subsidy, which is huge, left out all of the costs of decommissioning, which are huge, and then compare it against unsubsidised renewable energy. You know, there was also an issue about if they build the new nuclear power station, they could never build the Severn Barrage, which would create about 10 times the power that the nuclear power station would in a renewable way, in a sustainable way. And if they build the nuclear power station, the damage that they would do to the sediment in the Severn region would mean that you couldn't build the Severn Barrage. And that was just not mentioned. So if I would have been a member of the local community, considering whether I was going to respond to this consultation process that's supposed to be so open and transparent, I would have no idea of these facts. So I would be comparing apples to pears on cost. I would not have any idea of what the long-term environmental impacts were, what projects wouldn't happen as a result of it. It really turned me against nuclear power in particular, but also had me question, why the hell am I working on these projects anymore? You know, there's only so long you can keep telling yourself, well, it's okay because I'm on the council side. When you go, these guys are kind of in lockstep here. I get, you know, there's a kind of incestuous relationship that's going on here between the, you know, the sort of executive level of the councils and the energy producers. You know, these energy producers, like they produced it themselves. You know, this nuclear kind of corporocracy. So yeah, that was a real big one for me. And the last one that happened was literally the last project I did before I went off to Occupy, which was I was working in Bristol City Council, and they wanted to outsource the occupational health service for employees to Atos. And I was on that project, and I can remember a member of staff in that office. I had no idea who Atos were at the time. And she came to me and said, I know what you're telling me about what Atos could do. I'm there giving it all the big spiel in the, you know, presentations. It's going to be cheaper, it's going to be a better service, it's progress, we don't want this old fashioned, you know, councillors actually in the building waiting to consult with staff. You just want this progress, call centres all over the world, blah blah blah. And she just quietly came up to me one day and said, can you just read this? Says there was a spread in the Guardian about what Atos were doing with the, you know, I sat down and read it and I just felt sick. I was just like, this is what I'm doing, I'm one of these people, you know, and you have that process, and then Occupy Movement happened, and it was like, I'm going to go to that, and then I started writing, and now I can sleep at night. I think I'd probably be described as a revolutionary. I'm pretty radical. I don't see the tinkering as particularly effective. I think as long as you've got a central banking system that we have, as long as money is created, and I mean that's, I've not touched on it in this talk, but the whole way that money is even created in the first place, you know, as a debt owned by private companies, you've never got enough to pay it back because of the interest that goes on. So you're in this constant scrap. There literally isn't enough money. You know, I think that, you know, as long as that exists, you're not, it doesn't matter what economic system you live in, really. You could have, you know, social democracy, you could have capitalism, neoliberalist version of capitalism, you could have, you know, anything that you put in place. I think if you create money in the same way, if you have the barriers and the inequality in terms of, you know, opportunity, you know, in terms of the different educations that we have, the health inequalities that we have, I think you basically end up with the same world. I think that's part of the problem we've got, is that people aren't willing to be radical enough because it's scary. You know, it's happening now, coming up to this election, the amount of people I've spoken to who have been radical as hell up until the last 6 weeks, who are suddenly going, I'm just going to hold my nose and vote Labour. Why? you know, I will be that appointed. Why? What we've just spent the last... We've just agreed about what New Labour... The book also covers civil liberties. We haven't even touched on that tonight. You know, what New Labour did to civil... Everything else. Iraq. You know, what? Why would you do that? They go, oh, I just have to get rid of the Tories. And I'm actually preparing a piece that I'm going to release on the blog next week, which is about, we've got to start thinking about getting rid of dangerous ideologies, not getting rid of dangerous people. You know, and the problem is we get stuck in this cult of personality where one minute Blair is the worst monster in the world and Thatcher is the worst monster in the world and David Cameron is the worst monster in the world. And it's like, they're just tools of a monstrous ideology. So what, you're just going to keep inviting someone else in who smiles and maybe hugs a couple of kids today, and you know, in 5 years they're going to be going, he's a monster, she's a monster. You know, we have to get them out now. So, yeah, I think we really need a fundamental transformation in the whole thing, a whole reimagining of what is work. You know, how do we want to structure our lives? What's education? Why do we just have this arbitrary kind of 0 to 16 and we go, or 18, or, you know, if you do a PhD a little bit longer, but this only this early bit of your life that you get to teach and learn and have that, and then you're just supposed to get into a fixed career and then you just work and then you get a pension and then you die, you know? And I feel like the longer we stay in neoliberalism, whoever is running the show, the further away we move from that. The more people are reduced from the wholeness that they are, the parent, the friend, you know, the carer, the neighbour, they're reduced. All of these other roles that we play, which add such a huge value to society as a whole, are just reduced and reduced so that we can spend more and more of our time on this one thing we do, which is generate profit for somebody else. I think that's crazy. And to continue electing people that want to progress that agenda is crazy if you want to live in a world which is more equal, which is more fair, which is more loving and compassionate. Yeah, you've got to get radical. And so the next book is really, I can't wait to write the next book, is actually going to the people absolutely at the cutting edge of economics, at the cutting edge of education, at the cutting edge of health. And to me, they are actually the architects of our future world. They're starting to build it now. And it's actually talking to those people and getting that translated for other people as to what's actually happening. Because we never hear about it in the mainstream media or the kinds of avenues and channels of information that most people have access to. So they really do think it's, you know, to excuse the coarseness, but shit or bust. You know, it's like, it's this or nothing. So we'll have this. And actually, there are incredible things happening, not just in the UK, but around the world, that point out, actually, there's some really way better ways of doing this. And we could be hiding all of that off and developing. So, yeah, revolutionary.
I'll take one more question. Adam, yeah?
I'm filled with questions. I'm also looking forward to it now. But the question I will ask is, I mean, having written this book and looked at all the injustices and literal deaths and just the inequality of it all, how do you manage to take all that and the anger that must make you feel, how do you manage to take all that and turn it into this incredibly charming, polite, very erudite sort of way? Because the more I get involved, and I'm a Buddhist of 7 years, the more I get involved, the angrier I become, and the angrier I become, the less coherent my argument becomes.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. I think it's the first time I've ever been described as polite. I'm going to take that. Thank you. Yeah, actually, I went for a real kind of learning curve on that one myself. I could, and that's ongoing. I'm not like this every day. it's good or a bad thing, depending on how you're receiving me this evening. For me, it was going to Palestine. I made a film last year. I was in Gaza last summer for Operation Protective Edge, so I watched that happen. And when I first went out to Palestine when I was 21, I had my 21st birthday in Ramallah, while the Second Intifada was happening. And I came back about as angry as I've been as a human being. I just didn't even know where to... You ever had an emotion so strong you didn't even know where to put it? It's just like, you know. And the problem was that put a huge distance, because it was like me, my anger, and then people I was trying to relate to. So I couldn't have a conversation with people who didn't agree with me, because I just want to rip their head off. Right, really, you know, it's like you almost feel violent when, because it's so urgent to you. You know, you're like, this is serious, guys. People are literally dying, and you're sitting there doing nothing, worse than nothing. You're vilifying the people who are doing something. You know, I got that angry about it, and I lost my rag, and I lost some friends, and I didn't get anywhere. And I actually got to the point where I was so depressed and upset and downbeaten that I thought the only thing to do was just back off from the whole thing completely. And to be honest, that's why I became a management consultant. I just sold out. I just went, I can't even be with this. You know, these people are just having a laugh. These people who don't care like I do, they're just getting on with their lives. They're having a beer and they're enjoying themselves. What the hell am I wasting my time on this for? And then I think I was like 27, and I went off, and there's a course called Landmark Education, and I did a thing called the Landmark for it. And it's all about kind of putting your past in your past and getting complete with, you know, stuff that's happened that's really impacted your life. For me, that was transformative. I've actually been able to get that. You know, Israel didn't make me angry, and actually caring about the world didn't make me angry. I made me angry. I chose to, like, honour my anger over honouring a mission, you know, and actually being able to go, this is not about my own personal rage. This is about getting a world that works for everyone. What is more important, me losing my rag and being righteous, or is it changing the world?